associated with another by Dr. Sarath Gunapala. He is a well-known research scientist at NASA. So let us warmly welcome him. And also I would like to welcome the Chief of the Department of Science, Professor Devara Mahana, and Professor Devarasa, the head of the Department of Physics, and all the other staff of the department, and academic staff from other departments also. And also the members of IPSL and demonstrators and students from university and from other universities and from other institutes also. So I invite Professor Sarath Gunapala to introduce today's guest speaker to us.
Good afternoon, you all. Dean Faculty of Science and all the faculty members of the Faculty of Science, dear students, demonstrators and junior staff. So I am pleased and honored to introduce Dr. Gunapala to you all. He is a renowned scientist, as you all know. I have been honored because not because only he is a renowned scientist and a great researcher. He is my batchmate, so that's why I am very proud. And not only that, we were practical partners in the first year. So, actually, he entered the university in 1975. Those days, actually, special selections were done at the end of the first year, not like now. So, we were together and we were practical partners. Our batch was a very peculiar batch. We had 6 special students, we had 3 first classes, and 1 simple pass and 2 failures. So, don't ask me. Even these 2 failures are doing very well, actually. Most, one is even in failure, so don't think that failures is also failures, also pillars of success. Then we went on to the same university. Actually, he preceded me because I wanted to stay in Sri Lanka. At that time, even they could have joined the faculty because we didn't have enough lecturers. So for some reason, I want to join the department. So they went to Pittsburgh, University of Pittsburgh in 1980. Then I went there after 1 year in 1981 because since I got the permanent position here, I had to take study leave. So therefore I went there in 1981. So it was very easy for me because they were there. So they helped me a lot. Even we had apartments in the same building. So we cooked together. We ate together before getting married, but after we got married, actually, we tightly handed over the cooking part to our wife. But so we had a very great time there. So I don't want to talk a lot because I can talk even 1 hour, but I am wasting his time. So if I just want to give you a glimpse of what we were at that time. So, I don't know whether you can. So, this is because you all know him better, because all Sri Lankans know him the work that he has done. After graduating from University of Pittsburgh, I think for a short period he went to Rutgers University. Then he went to Bell Labs. Then finally he ended up at NASA. So he has, I think, more than 300 journal publications, 350 presentations, 80 artworks, invited talks, I think, all over the globe. And he has 22 patents, so you name it, he has everything. So I don't want to waste, it's not wasting time, but I'm wasting his time because he's the speaker here. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Gunapala, he's enlightening us. Thank you.
Spectral region for NASA for remote sensing application. So basically I still solve protein equation every day. And that's the distance we do. So we design everything from first principles, first physics principles. Then we grow our material. We fabricate everything in our clean rooms. Then we fabricate all the detectors. We integrate them with the subsystems and integrate them into the instruments. And finally, integrate it into the spacecraft. So here we have built everything from physics to the final space. So that's kind of our strength anyway. So then we can then put it into the network and ship the tape camera, and they make launching vehicles and launch in the first 7 minutes tape camera and for the orbit. Usually US system, launching system is two stages. First stage take the orbit, second stage take beyond the orbit. So after 7 minutes, they transfer the teleport to APL. So APL has something called the Deep Space Network. I'm not going to talk about here. All satellites we send beyond Earth to Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, and Pluto, and even beyond solar system. So some satellites are far away, even with the light speed. It takes hours for radio signal to travel. The furthest is wider, it takes 14 hours to travel 1 minute, 14 hours to travel back. That's another. So, we have to have a system that we can monitor 24/7. So, our control tower works, operation center works 24/7, 8 hour shifts. So, we run day and night, even holidays. Because you cannot have a spacecraft beyond holiday, keep moving. Then we have one set of 70-meter antenna in California, and another set in Madrid, Spain, and another set in Canberra, Australia. So that way, each cover 120 degrees. So it doesn't matter, Earth spins, we talk to them all the time. I'll give a brief introduction to JPL. When you talk about Jet Propulsion Laboratory or JPL is brief, you cannot ignore California Institute of Technology. That's our parent organization. So Caltech was actually not Caltech, it was founded in 1891 as a group university, University. Then later it went through many transitions. Somewhere around 1920, it was named as the California Institute of Technology, and pushed by George Hale, he kind of the pioneer of the telescopes, and that time he helped shape not only Caltech, but Pasadena as well. Caltech is a pretty small university, one city block. They take only 200 undergraduates per year, that's all. There's no human, it's only science, no medical school. Whatever you do in Caltech, you have to take physics all 4 years. That's the language. 200 undergraduates, 800 students, 1,000 researchers, 335 faculty. So their first claim to fame was a noise probe experiment by its president. Andrew Middleton, modern physics, long time ago. So he discovered that charge of electrons is just 1.6 in Coulomb, but it's 1, cannot be, it's discrete, cannot be part of a fraction. So now Caltech generated 38 Nobel laureates. So in 1936, Caltech did the graduate student experiment. As a result, the JPL was formed. At that time, it was only few people trying to launch rockets from an area called Lakshmiyada, 5 miles west of Caltech. And today we are in the same place. How it looks like right now at the foot of San Diego Mountain. So this is how they started in 1936. 1936. The first place to train was JATO. JATO means Jet Nursing Center Takeoff for aircraft during Second World War. So aircrafts cannot go and slowly take off in any territory, they can get shut down. So the JATO is a jet rocket attached to the wings, so it helps to take off very fast in any territory. So many who hear of that went out and formed companies and got really rich. Their second place to fame was the development of first guided missile for US Army. In early days, JPL was funded by US Army. So then JPL, the third claim to fame is they gave the first orbiting satellite to the United States Explorer 1 in 1958, January 28. Of course, after Sputnik 1 and 2, but in 1957, but the Explorer 1 is the first satellite with scientific instruments. The Sputnik didn't have any scientific instruments. So, this is at that time JPL director William Pickering, the that time chief scientist Van Allen, and this guy is one from he designed. So he decided to put a guided counter that discovered the Van Allen belt radiation belt. So that's the kind of the brief history of JPL. This is actually my building that I work, Micro Devices Laboratory. We do, as I mentioned to you earlier, we have all the tools fabricate semiconductor devices and subsystems. Basically, it's a fab house. We have glass, 10 to glass, 1,000. So, glass can mean only 10 dust particles per cubic meter. Much bigger than an operating theater. So, today we have 31 robotic spacecraft in solar system and beyond, and 8 major instruments. So these are the 4 different types of spacecraft we use to explore the solar system and beyond. The first one is called a flyby. So it doesn't get enter into orbit, we launch, it just fly close to planets and keep on going. So I'll talk more about that. Then, of course, the orbiter, from the name, is very clear. We send a satellite, it gets into a gravity field of a planet and enter and orbit. That needs a little bit more work. Then the other kind is for the lander, that needs even more work. So that goes and enter into orbit, then it has to descend and then finally land. So we use 3 phases, enter into the right phase, entry, descent, and the last 100 meters or so for the landing. So that means much more work. The last kind is the rovers, so it's a lander plus mobile instrument. So the landing part can start moving. So that's of course very expensive, but you can get more science out of it because this one doesn't have any mobile instrument. The first example for flyby is a wide emitter. Of course, it goes dark before I went to the United States. JPL developed this spacecraft and launched in 1977. They used 11,000 man-years to develop that in about 10 years. So the today's worth is about $5.5 billion that do that. So they built 1 and 2. It has 10 major instruments. The idea is our previous laboratory director was the science PI on this one, Professor Stone of Caltech. He calculated and found out the planets going to align, the large gas planet, gas jet going to align in late 70s to 80s. So Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. So if we do one mission, we can also form. So JPL pitched that idea to NASA and they funded. So they built 2 of them, Voyager 1 and Voyager 2. So the, they sent first wider one, then 2 weeks later they launched wider two. They are powered by we call the RTG, radio isotope thermal generator. So I'll talk a little bit about that later, because you cannot get solar energy when you go far away, because it gets dark and darker, cold, and solar cells won't work, not enough solar energy. So when it arrived on Jupiter, the first thing it has seen is Io. Io is one of the Galilean moons, the Io in Europa, Callisto, Ganymede, the polar moon, the size of our somewhat bigger than ours. So it detected the volcano, two volcanoes were erupting that time. That's the first time we have seen the volcanic action beyond our planet. Then Voyager 2 arrived 2 weeks later, and still it was erupting in Antilles. And also, for the first time from Voyager, they found Jupiter has a ring. Get the material to its ring like Saturn, but it's a very small ring from the material it's getting from Io. So it has taken so many thousands of pictures, and it's a great spread spot. Spread spot. Then after its encounter with the Jovian system, it went to Saturn. And so this is a Saturnian system. It's a nice spring system. Saturn is mostly ice, and its core has methane and hydrogen. Its density is so light, if you put Saturn on water, it floats. So one of the major discoveries done by Voyager is it observed remotely Saturn's largest moon, Titan, and it found hydrocarbon power on Titan. So then they found that hydrocarbon cloud is methane, CH4, which is very important for astrobiology. That's one of the things that primordial soup needs there. So since then, they were very interested to find out what's going on. Titan from ground, but it's very hard to observe. It has a very thick cloud deck, and the cloud deck mostly methane and ethane. So it's very hard to see from visible light. Then this is Enceladus. Enceladus is a very small moon. It's all ice. It reflects like 100% of its light. From Voyagers, Voyager 1 and 2, we found Saturn has about 15 or 16. Jupiter has 15 or 16 light moons, and then there are about something like 40 some small moons. And they are not really big moon, they are deeply captured from Jupiter's gravity, some asteroids and so on. So the same thing goes with Saturn, it also has about 60 some pieces of it big moon, but only several, not several, about 15 or so large. Then it went to Uranus. And they found the Uranus also has a fairly thick atmosphere and a cloud deck. It has a coldest atmosphere, I think, so 49 Kelvin. Then it went to explore Neptune. After Neptune, it left the solar system. And when it left the solar system, JPL turned the spacecraft around and took a picture of the whole solar system. And of course, with the Mosaic. And they mark all the planets here. At that time, they calculate the intensity of the sun. It goes about a 5-watt bulb. That's a bulb in a refrigerator. So, obviously, solar cells won't work. So, at that time, the idea was for Voyagers to go forever and monitor for 50 years. Why 50 years? Usually, when you send satellite, about 50% to 2/3 of its base is fuel, liquid hydrogen. And we use liquid hydrogen to guide the spacecraft and also keep its antenna aligned towards Earth. the transmission power of its antenna is 10 watts. So even with the 70 meter antenna, what we get is 1/1,000,000,000 of the power used by your digital watch. So it's very little power. So by in 50 years, we calculated it will run out of its field. So after that, the antenna may misalign with Earth, then we won't be able to communicate with Voyager. But even today, after 37 years, we are communicating with both Voyager 1 and Voyager 2. So Voyager 2 was coming 2 weeks behind. Both were functioning really nice. So they made an immediate decision after Voyager 1. They thought it's no point of sending two along the same path. So they sent Voyager 1 under the belly of Jupiter, used its gravity pull, and deflected it perpendicular to the solar plane. So Voyager 1 is wearing a spring perpendicular to the solar plane. Solar plane is the planet's orbit. Voyager 2 is the one that explored Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune. So it's very different along the solar plane. About 2 years ago in 2012, Voyager 1 and it's actually not very straight. Voyager 1 went this way, Voyager 2 went this way. Both crossed this interface called a helio key. This is the sun right here, and sun emits solar wind. It goes everywhere and interacts with the cold dust in the universe. Universe is cold, 4 Kelvin, 269 Celsius. And dark, it will become cold elemental dust. So this supersonic solar wind interact with the dust, go from those who are transiting from supersonic to subsonic. So there should be a shock wave here, and that's the phase that has a shock wave here when it's moving in the along here, because our sun is moving in the roughly about 200 miles per second, something like that. Earth moves about 18 or 20 miles per second around the sun. Sun moves about 200 miles per second around the galactic center. So because of that, there's a shock wave here, and this area is called a helio key. So it crossed both wire 1 and 2, 6 months apart, across the helio key. It was measured by its plasma wave. So at that time, Professor Carl Sagan, he was a proponent of this project from Cornell University, he suggested to put a golden record, size of a LT. It's made from copper and made gold deposited. It has greeting from 55 languages. It has Ayubova. JPL had the one spare record in our visitor center. We used to play that. I heard Ayubova, but it played so many times, but millions of times over years, probably 3 decades. And it was worn out, and they got rid of that. So it's no longer there. But it has 115 pictures of various scenes from Earth, and also classical music, rock music, and readings from various things, various dignitaries, that time U.S. President Carter, the U.S. General Secretary at that time, the war time, and so on. And also they put a needle and a science in symbolic language. Ever intercepted by a space-faring nation or some intelligent life, they should be able to play. And also it has symbolically marked where we are in our military galaxy, so they can take a view from where it's in here. It's moving away from us about 10 miles per second, so it will take 40,000 years to get close to the nearest star. So the major finding from this flyby grand mission is found a ring system on Jovian system that's around Jupiter. how can you say rough sense on IO on the hydrocarbon cloud I so then now it's employing this only two satellites one field outsource system now the landers I'm not going to talk much about this is one of the recent landers for the Phoenix landed on Mars solar powered with the two solar arrays Mars is a fairly dry planet but scientists notice its polar caps are growing in winter time so when it's expanding they thought it might have water ice so at that time scientists believed Mars may have a lot of remaining water because it has no running water on the surface they thought there may be underground lake or even water exists in permafrost permafrost is a frozen mud there are a lot of water in north pole south pole frozen mud so this idea of Phoenix lander is it has a robotic arm dig soil and do some chemistry experiment to find out whether it has water so today is a different story and we'll talk about that later orbiters I selected Cassini is one of the grand missions we have three types of missions one is called flagship mission any mission more than $1 billion class is a flagship mission wider is a flagship mission if it's less $1 billion or less around $1 billion they are called new horizon missions it's $500 million or less they are called a discovery So Cassini is a flagship mission. It took JPL 15 years to develop, $3.7 billion mission. It was launched in 1997, but we didn't have a powerful enough first and second stage to launch it directly to Saturn. So it was launched to inner solar system, toward Venus. So it went and fell into Venus gravity pull and got a slingshot for the gravity assisted acceleration. Came to Earth, went around Earth, using shots around Earth, then finally went to Jupiter, fell into Jupiter's gravity, and stole a little bit of inertia from Jupiter's heat a little bit, and but accelerated then to Saturn in 2004. So it's the largest spacecraft even ever sent beyond Earth, 30,000 pounds, 30 feet long, and this is called a high-jump probe. Given by Italian Space Agency and the whole idea of the Huygens probe was to deploy that and enter that one into the Huygens and so it has a parachute it was released 6 months before it reached Saturn and calculated path it went independently and opened up its parachute and entered the Huygens at that time the mother spacecraft who writes about that that was a fan, so it worked fine. So it opened the parachute, it went down and taking pictures and videos and things like that. Transmitted the data to other spacecraft so it can store and send it back to Earth. So first few miles of cloud deck, it was hopping. We can see after that it cleared up and it took these videos when it went down, it's in the web, so you can go and surf through. So finally it landed, when it was landed and before landing, so many pictures and videos, we found it has rivers and lakes and oceans. And its rivers have liquid methane and ethane, not water. Also it rains ethane. So its atmosphere is very dynamic, they interact with the surface. So astrobiologists are really interested in space. So this is actually the most recent picture I got from JPL even after I came here. Cassini took that one, it flew over Titan recently and it has seen solar light, sunlight reflecting off from its seeds. That's solar radiation, sunlight reflecting off from its portions. This is one of the volcanoes on Titan. It doesn't spill lava instead of just spray water and then make it and then water in my body. Also, you probably heard about aurora borealis, the solar wind arms trapped into our magnetic field and then get accelerated when it hit the earth, like a magnetic panel, and so it make plasma ionize again, make plasma into nice colors. So we have observed aurora borealis, aurora effect on Saturn, Saturn's north pole and as well as south pole. Also recently, JPL scientists have found some lightning activity on Saturn. So lots of things. So then, this is quite interesting. The answer is that scientists are not interested at all. It was a pretty small moon. Titan is 3200 mile diameter moon, very similar to our moon. Enceladus is 310 miles. But then when they took the Voyager didn't have a very good camera that night, and also it was the flyby, so it was it flew like 500,000 miles away from the planet. It won't get trapped in the gravity. But Cassini found it has rivers. These blue lines are major rivers flowing on Enceladus. And not only that, Enceladus has geysers and they are spewing material, water and a lot of particles out, and they actually contributing to enlarge the Saturn's rings. Saturn's rings are also ice particles. So then Cassini collected some sample using mass spectrometer and found these compartments. So it has methane, water vapor, methane and various kinds of carbon. So it's quite interesting. And now JPL is proposing a grant mission, a flagship mission to Titan and Enceladus. Also JPL is proposing a grant mission, a flagship mission to Europa. After Voyager, JPL, I think this year, JPL sent a flagship mission for Galileo to Jupiter. And he found one of the Jovian moons, Galilean moons, called Europa, had ice crust, and the ice crust has cracks. And these cracks are developing every day. And so it was a puzzle for a while. Then they found actually what's happening is that, like when moon moves above us, we get the tidal waves, right? So even approximately 6 centimeters. So the same thing happening in Jovian system, it has all these four big moons. So other big moons go over Europa all the time. So the Europa's ice crust goes up and down, it breaks. And so they think this grinding is probably providing enough energy for Europa to have a ocean beneath its ice sheet. So we are proposing a flagship mission for ice core. Set a robotic spacecraft and land and build through the ice crust and then go like submarine and see and life to find the way as signs of life or even primordial zone. The last example is a Curiosity. That's our most recent flagship mission. It was launched in 2011. The first rover we did was a Pathfinder, size wagon, solar powered, solar cell powered. Then the second set of exploration rovers we call the Spirit and Opportunity. They were about 10 times bigger, again solar powered. And primary mission supposed to be 1 month, extended mission 2 months. And both are still working 10 plus years. But the problem is one better stuck in the sand is the other one, the wheels are worn out. So it's running with instead of 6 wheels now going from 2 wheels. Curiosity is a much larger rover. Its size is very similar to a E4 SUV, 1,000 kilogram in weight. So obviously solar power is not going to do anything. So this is powered by nuclear power. It's not a nuclear reactor, it's called RPG, radiation of thermal generator. For physics, it's probably very interesting. We do this thermocouple experiment, so that's how we make that one. We put a bimetal, the space is one end, pretty cold. The other end, we put a plutonium dioxide pellet. So because of radioactivity, that side is pretty hard. So when you put hundreds of such thermocouples, it generates a lot of power. Generate 440 watts. Half-life of plutonium is like 200 some years, or easily 1,000 years in that power. Not only that, this plutonium heat, this has a radiator system. In Mars at night, it gets pretty cold, so it circulates liquid inside, so in nights, it can keep the electrons warm. This has 10 major instruments. Mass scan, chem scan, it's a chemistry experiment. It has a spectrometer and a high resolution camera. The camera can take high resolution images and stick them to make panoramas. This radiation detector, this APSX is the alpha proton X-ray spectrometer, has a radioactive source material, so it can be proton as well as alpha particle. Alpha particle can do the other kind of scattering. I don't know, we have that extra. Physics, we have a sort of a background. From that, you can find the elements because the alpha particle goes and goes back. The size of the nucleus, you can find the material. And protons, also help you to analyze the material. So from that, you can find what material. One is Mars. So Mars handheld lens image. It's basically a magnifying lens. For geologists, that's the most important instrument. And the lens. So it's a pretty small lens with a high resolution camera for geologists, so they can inspect rocks and mountains. And this is a real bit, so it can drill at home, take samples for chemistry experiments and also X-ray diffraction. Also, it has a project to need the surface of sample rocks. MARDI is a Mars descent imager. I'll explain that in a little bit. It was active only during descent. HEMIN is chemistry and mineralogy. It has basically a chemistry experiment that chemists can do in the lab. SAM is 50% of the payload, sample analysis on Mars. That has three instruments. One is a gas chromatograph, the other one, mass spectrometer. The third one is for a laser, universal laser spectrometer. So basically it's a habit cell, a pretty small one with the two mirrors, concave mirrors, a tube. One side has a laser, the laser fires, so it goes back and forth millions of times and you can effectively tap length of kilometers. In the middle of the other side has a little detector. So the whole idea is to detect gases, so you can search and open the gate valve, take Martian gas sample and close it and fire the laser. And there's a bunch of lasers where the main experiment is to find methane, of course the plenty of methane. Methane has two kinds. So one is the geological methane, CH4, when the solar system was formed. Methane was formed by basically CH4. Then carbon has three isotopes, carbon 12, 13, and 14. 13 and 14 radioactive. So that's what you do with the carbon dating and find the age, right? So then, if Mars had life, the waste of life also makes methane biogas. So, with that, we know Mars from other experiments from Spirit Opportunity and Pathfinder. Mars has water something like 70 to 200 million years in that range, it has to be water. Then, if it had life, that life should have formed some form, some methane. That's because of biological methane. And that's fresh. that should have a different carbon where the journey for breakers. So because of that, it should have a slightly different hyperfine spectrum. So the idea is to, from the laser, you know, the laser spectrum, to find the biomechanism. Its laser was very particularly designed and tuned and fabricated by my group to find that mimic. But unfortunately, we didn't find that mimic. That is a neutron detector. The neutrons coming from cosmic rays, and if there's a water on the ground mass, the reflected neutron gets blown up. Otherwise, it reflects with the same energy. So that's the idea behind the dynamic neutron detector. Frankly, it's a weather station. It monitors temperature, pressure, wind, and things like that. So when the Curiosity was landed, it has over 10,000 components. Only one wind sensor was broken. All other things were broken. So it's a $2.5 billion mission. So this is where I plan to land the Gale crater, 150 meter diameter crater in the middle. It has a mound. Why we selected that one? The geologic thought is probably had the water some millions of years ago. So there's things formed because of this water. They wanted to find that, and obviously signs of many life. So this is an artistic rendering of, there was probably a river here and water accumulated and made some lake here. So I said the Mars vision camera, this whole rover was folded and packed into a conical shaped can. And on the top of the can, the parachute was embedded, and the bottom is a deep heap, and that whole thing was attached. I didn't have a picture attached to a circular stage that was a cabinet stage from Earth to Mars. So when it reached Mars after 7 months, a Martian year is a 2 Earth years. So what we do is we have enough money and energy, we could launch a satellite to Mars anytime. We don't do that. What we do is we, every other year Mars and Earth get closer. So we plan and send it to the Mars mount and we, so we can send it with least energy. So in that trip, it takes about 7 to 8 months. So we send that thing, so before it enters the orbit, entry point, it detects the state and the cabinet state, and then at that point it's a conical shaped thing. And the bottom is a heat shield, it enters into a particular angle. If it is too deep, air resistant too high, get burned. If it is too high angle, a glancing angle, it can bounce off from the atmosphere. Never mind. So you have to enter into the right angle, not a 90 degree right angle, correct angle. Then if the start to descend, everything happens in 4 minutes, 3.5 to 4 minutes. At that time, even though we are closer, the radio signal takes 10 minutes to go there, 10 minutes to come back. So you have to do everything autonomous. So everything has to go perfect. The 3 teams work, entry, descent, and landing. So this time we decided to do the safe landing. In the previous versions, we didn't have a good map and all the technology, so we put deflated balloons around our can. So just before it entered the surface, we inflate the balloon, so it bounces off. And several and deflate balloons and over on South River. But this one we couldn't use that technique, it's too heavy for balloons. So we decided to do a smart landing with the jetpack. So the jetpack and everything was in the conical can. When it was doing the aero braking, at some point its temperature of this the shield, the heat shield that was going through the aero braking, its temperature reached to about 3900 Fahrenheit. At that point, that spaceship jettison this one and send it out so it can get rid of the heat. So when you get rid of the heat, the bottom is gone. Now the body is a mass descending measure, so it was taking pictures at that point. So when it was blown off, it took a picture. So it was taking 4 frames per second, so this was falling off. So then it was started in Mars, it was taking 4 frames per second, and it has a software package. It was trying to analyze those images and find a safe landing place. We wanted to avoid 4 different things. We wanted to avoid the small craters, rocks, boulders, slopes, and also distant. Those are bad. So as soon as we found a 10 meter by 10 meter area without those, that's our landing place all around. Because our jetpack also didn't have much fuel. So it's a limited amount of fuel. So this is imaged by Mani, or one of the images, is an image. So this time it was very close to the surface, and the jetpack was going, burning really hard. It was blowing off soil, Martian soil. This was very close to the touchdown. This is the jetpack with the engine, and it was holding the 1,000 kilogram rover with the 3 table. When it touched, the tension goes down, and at that point, it snapped the 3 tables, and then this fly away and fall out. So the whole job of this one is to take the rover and save the tank. The way we jettison this, they are all attached with the pyrotech bolts. Pyrotech bolts is a bolt with the compass in the middle and computer control. So when the computer sends a signal, it explodes right away. So it's one of the most reliable things in space technology. So you can, that's what we use in jettisoning. The landing site called the Bradley site, and this is the pair moved. So far it traveled more than 3 kilometers, or more than 10 kilometers. It has traveled through. So this is the landing site. You can see we never expected that. It has blown off few feet of soil, and even the rocks were burned from the jets. I didn't have the picture at that time. We have a couple of orbiters around Mars. We pointed one of the orbiters, it took the image with the parachute, it was going down. So this is a picture, and the water must have gone through this area. The geologists, and also there's a sign in addition to all the chemistry. These rocks, geologists telling, it has 2 types of rocks, mafic and celtic, I think. The mafic has more heavy metal, the celtic has less heavy metal, the classic celtic is granite. And look at these granite pebbles, they are all kind of smooth edges, they don't have a jagged edges. Everywhere on Mars is a jagged edges. So the geologist telling, if that happened, that means water was running here for thousands of years, or perhaps millions. Any rock you find on a riverbed is all smooth. You cannot find jagged. So it rolls and it grinds and gets smooth. The same thing happens with the sand. The sand you find in riverbeds is very smooth, never under microscope. But if you get sand from some machinery, if you break concrete or something, they have jagged edges. So that's another evidence. This artist is the rendering of the image, rendered image. That's where they think there was it did the chemistry analysis and effects analysis and found these elements on Martian rocks, very similar to the rocks you find on Earth. Then this path has gone through. So the chemical has 2 types of soil, mafic and calcic soil. So more example of celtic granite types of stuff and rounded edge pebbles indicative of running water. Of course now it is moving into the rock nest, another area to investigate. So there it did some samples. This is before it did the scoop samples. JPL wanted to make sure the soil is smooth. So it went and applied brake to find out the depth and the softness of the soil. Then it's a scoop, because scoop cannot break something and the school for the software. This is more example of these rounded pebbles and nice soil that has a spherical shape. This is taken from the geologist that the magnifying glass by the camera, the lens with the high resolution camera. This is X-ray diffraction data. It is noisy because about 40% of Martian soil is uncrystalline, very typical of Earth. Also, the heated the soil, when you heat the soil, it releases a large amount of water vapor. So Mars still has some water, but it's associated with the metals. It's in the form of hydrates. Also, it has given CO2, oxygen, and other gases, sulfur dioxide. This selfie is used at the Mali camera, the handheld selfie measure, and took 55 images to make this self-image. Also, it measured the temperature, Martian temperature in a good summer day, 0 Celsius. We have nice weather. The night temperature dropped to minus 100 Celsius because it's a dry. Its atmosphere is about 1% of Earth, 96% carbon dioxide. Doesn't have much water vapor. Because it doesn't have much water vapor, it cannot retain the heat. It's like a desert weather. Like in Southern California, where I live, is a very desert weather. So, it's a desert development. So, our humidity is always like a less than 10%. So, you want sweat, but it can get really hot. But in summertime, in Fahrenheit, temperature goes to 100. But in night, it drops to 60. So, 40 degrees change. It won't happen in the East Coast because it's so humid. What happened here, in Celsius it's a 20 degree drop, it's a big drop. So Mars, it drop is 100. But in daytime, it keeps up very big, 90 drop. Mars has a very, very weak magnetic field. So it doesn't have a Van Allen belt equivalent. So my friend who monitor its radiation, one day we must do a man mission, they have known the radiation level. They said this radiation level is 1 sievert. I don't know that unit, but they said it is about 1,000 times higher than Earth because it doesn't have belts. So the solar wind hit directly. So when in daytime, solar wind hit, the radiation level goes high. At that time, the air gets heated up, the pressure drops. This is that experiment I explained, so I'm going to skip that. So now it is moving further to explore the yellowknife, that's the area they named. So they found more heat rock, and actually some of these are due to wind erosion, not water. And there are more signatures of previous riverbeds here, then more rock formation. Very similar to Earth. Then they found these rocks that have veins. Earth also, you can find this kind of rocks with veins. These veins on rocks they find on Earth are filled with calcium sulfate. So they did this experiment to find out what's in the veins, and they found out actually it's calcium sulfate. When they did the apex, they found, and a lot of the bacteria, they found it has SO3 plus calcium oxide and calcium sulfate. So before they did that apex experiment, they cleaned the surface of this main rock with this brush on its robotic arm. Also, they found the sheet of rock that has these little bubbles called the spherules. So on Earth, geologists always find for water seep through sheet rock, and it comes back and makes these spherules. It's a signature that water seeps through the rock. So you find the same thing on Mars. Don't find because the project manager used to walk with us lunch, after lunch for exercise. Unfortunately, he passed away before it launched, so we gave their name, we say they are the Lord Mahi. So before he filled the sample handling system is at the end of the robotic arm. So it has poured the sample here. Even in that, you can see the vein rock, and these veins have calcium sulfate. And also when they heat at the rock, it releases, same as soil, it releases a lot of water vapor, carbon dioxide, oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur, etc. So in a nutshell, Mars, geology on Mars is quite similar to Earth. It has fine-grained rocks that suggest that it has changed in riverbed. The mineralogy indicates sustained interaction with liquid water that was not too acidic for alkaline. The key chemical ingredients for life are present, such as carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphorus, sulfur. So, presence of minerals in various states, oxidation states, suggests that it can have a very primitive life even today, like a bacteria type thing, gain energy from dissociation or these oxides. So, that's what they think. So, what happened to the water? In earlier, I said the scientists thought it would probably have water droplet or from across. So, my planetary scientist friend who analyzed this data, they told me recently, no, that was wrong. It's what is born most of all. What happened was, Mars, the planetary scientist Paul, our planet is at 6 planet, it is 4 years working beyond the half 80 mile crust, some places in it. So Mars, 4 is dead. It has a volcanic activity, everything, now it's dead. The dead planet. So it doesn't have a volcanic things, plate movements, nothing. The magnetic field is marked. So very little magnetic field. So it's not enough to block the stop the solar wind. So what happens is solar wind comes and hits really hard. And it's like sandblasting. Sandblasting its atmosphere. And then on top of that, Mars is 1/3 of Earth. The gravity is 1/3 of Earth. The gravity is not very strong to hold a big atmosphere. Now the solar wind is blasting. It's just giving the energy to molecules, and the molecules are leaving Martian atmosphere. Our orbiters actually detecting a little bit of water vapor and everything leaving Mars. So when that happened, the atmospheric pressure dropped. And everything has three phases, right? So the liquid also has three phases: solid, ice, liquid water, vapor water. So if you, the Martian atmospheric pressure is so low, if you keep a glass of water, it just evaporates. It cannot support and sustain the liquid. So all these rivers, lakes, everything, over the millions of years, it just evaporated in the atmosphere and formed. That's what happened to my body. So scientists are interested to find one day that the same thing might happen to us, of course, but now millions of years later, you don't have to worry about that. So more panoramic pictures of Mars. Then my last few slides, I'm running over, sorry, to keep you here. The search for life, quite interesting thing. Exploration is built into our DNA, and the human always curious, want to explore. And when dark, clear skies, when we see all these heavenly bodies, so humans are always thinking, are we alone? Are there life there? So we always want to find. So the NASA has a program called Origins Program, and its first satellite is called Kepler. Kepler was launched in 2009. Primary mission, the TI is from NASA, JPL is the satellite, and control the satellite. The whole idea is to find planets orbiting around medium-sized stars. Why medium-sized? Generally, I mean, there are many, many categories of the stars. but generally you can classify between one really large giant stars, like a red giant. Their burn rate is so high, they won't last about 200 million in this time, or less. So they explode. Then a medium-sized star like our sunlight star, they're very steady. They can go for like 10 billion years. Very steady. We all life, we need a steady age time. So we are interested in medium-sized stars. And I'm talking around medium-sized stars. Then there are duo stars. If you're not interested, they are so small, their gravity is not enough to turn on the thermonuclear switch. There's no nuclear energy, no fusion. There's so many plasma balls, so round or so we are not worrying about that. In fact, we found some planets orbiting around some round dwarf about 15 light years from Earth. But even if there's water on those planets, they're probably frozen because the star cannot give enough energy. So we are interested in finding Earth-like planets orbiting around medium-sized stars like our Sun. Finding planets is very difficult because sky is so bright and the planet is not emitting anything and it's orbiting very close to the stars. So it's very hard. The analogy is something like if you have a flashlight here and trying to find a moth, a fly, you will be with this flashlight. It's very difficult, right? So that's the kind of the analogy. So, a clever guy, probably Jeff Marcy of Berkeley, that time he was in a different field. About 15 years ago, he found a nice technique. He was staring at the stars with a high resolution camera. Then the planets wobble. The stars wobble. Our Sun also wobbles because the Jupiter going around and it's, if the Jupiter becomes 60 times heavier, it's going to be a star by itself. So, it's 1,000 times heavier than Earth. So it hugs when it goes around. So as Saturn, we don't do much. So because of that, some wobble. So you look for a long time, you can see every most of the stars wobble. Then you can go back and calculate what kind of planets are going around. Then you can use the Kepler's equation and all that. You can calculate something. So that. Then after that, the scientists found actually four other methods. Not going in detail what these methods, but number two, transit method is more popular now. That's what the Kepler used. Transit method is a star is here and your planet is orbiting. And when the planet goes in between us and the star, the light gets dimmed by 1 million. So if you have a very nice, very sensitive photometer, you get a dip. But then it's periodic, a dip. So from that, that's what we use in Kepler. Using that, we found, I don't know, I lost track of that. Right now, we probably found something close to 5,000 planets. But again, most of the planets are big ones. Some smaller ones. But then they used recently a Hubble and got the light that comes from the star goes through the planet's atmosphere. They found some signatures of hydrogen and oxygen on the water. But the today's technology is not powerful enough to find all these things, the water signature and everything. So the NASA is launching a James Webb Space Telescope, 6 meter diameter mirror in under. So that should have 36 times more power than Hubble, so we should be able to do more planet finding with that. Then the JPL is developing the terrestrial planet finder that will go even beyond Jupiter's orbit to cut down the solar noise. And if that is a parameter, we should be able to find not only water on such planets, like planets, even signatures of strong so that's where we are moving. With that slide, I'd like to conclude my presentation. So thank you very much for listening. If you have some questions, more than happy to answer. Perhaps I can answer, maybe I can't answer. So. question? There's no question, it's a dumb question. You can ask anything.
I think
that not really, US doesn't have much. There was a renewed interest in the last several years to explore Moon. Moon doesn't have atmosphere. Several years ago, actually, I had an opportunity to write one of the astronauts, Harrison, he was the last American astronaut to walk. So, his vacuum is actually 10 to the minus 12 toes. On those who do vacuum science know that 10 to the minus 12 is a darn difficult vacuum to make on Earth. Very difficult. So hardly anything there. So, because of that, he showed me a picture under the sun. I think it's degrees temperature. But then he put a thermometer on a shadow. Under the shadow is minus 200 some Celsius. Because it's not atmosphere. So if you want to do, you know, how nice moon or anything for any reason, I mean, you need water. So scientists were thinking, and maybe still they're thinking, it has a very deep crater in the south pole of moon. So never seen sunlight. So its temperature should be really cold, you know, some minus 200, some Celsius. So scientists believe there may be a glacier. If there's a glacier, then you know you can tap that and make water and you can do some things. So far no evidence, no solid evidence of that glacier. So without that, it doesn't have it. Of course, I mean, there's a Indian satellite, Chandraya, when they have found water, but that water is less than the water on Mars. It's in forms of ice. It's not the deepest water. You can ask anything, you can ask from the single issue. Something like a, but we don't have, we have no more, one right, we get fine. mind, but the bad mind because it is okay. But anyway, life is better. Yeah, but then of course we have to control the distances between the satellites to the half wave. Using physical light, half mind mind, the distance between the telescope and the satellites has to be quarter mind mind. Very high accuracy. Otherwise, you cannot get that problem. Get this problem. There are lots of challenges. No question.
Reports of his lecture.